not in the name of the Most High. All praise due to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and peace be upon Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. I testify that there is no God except Allah, and I testify that Muhammad is the Prophet and the Messenger of Allah. And I thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for making us from amongst those who get together for the sake of Allah, to know more about Allah Azza wa Jalla, and to learn more about the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And when you come to the masjid, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives you for every step that you take a reward, and for every step that you take, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala also wipes away sin from you. So it's a great ni'mah from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala upon us to be from amongst those who come to the house of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to be the guests of Allah. And you are the guest of Allah. And the guest has rights upon his host, because your host is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And you have rights upon your host, Allah azza wa jal. And the rights that you have upon your host, that your host gives you the best hospitality. And the hospitality that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is going to give you is that he's going to forgive you, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will make you from amongst those that he'll promise the Jannah. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgive us and make us from amongst those that he promises the Jannah. Ameen ya Rabbil Alameen. Brothers and sisters, tonight we're going to be talking about a beautiful chapter which is part of the true quality of a believer, which is Babul Afwi wal I'radi anil Jahilin, the chapter of pardoning and forgiving others, and at the same time ignoring the ignorant people. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran Kareem, خُذِ الْعَفْوَ وَأْمُرْ بِالْعُرْفِ وَأَعْرِضْ عَنِ الْجَاهِلِينَ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commands the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. This command is to the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and to every follower of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to the Day of Judgment, including you and me. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commands the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, in which Allah says to him, خُذِ الْعَفْوَ, show forgiveness. O Muhammad, show forgiveness. خُذِ الْعَفْوَ وَأْمُرْ بِالْعُرْفِ, and enjoin which is good. Enjoin which is good. وَأَعْرِضْ عَنِ الْجَاهِلِينَ, and abstain away and keep away from the foolish people, from the ignorant people. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala also says in the Quran Kareem, فَاصْفَحْ الصَّفْحَ الْجَمِيلِ, and pardon, the beautiful pardoning. Pardoning, عَفُو, we pardon one another for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You do something wrong to me. You've wronged me, I've wronged you. Yes, you are in the wrong, I'm in the wrong. But pardon me for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Forgive me for the sake of Allah azza wa jal. This grudge that we carry against one another, that sometimes that we can't even get over. Someone does wrong to you, someone does something wrong to you, you don't even want to forgive them anymore. Even if they come and seek your forgiveness, even if they come and apologize to you, even if they come to you 1,000 times, forgive me, forgive me, forgive me, you're up yourself and over the top, and you've got this pride that you don't even want to forgive your brother and sister when they seek your forgiveness. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commands the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the one that does not carry any grudge against anyone, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commands him to pardon, to forgive. And that's the quality of a believer. Amongst Muslims, someone does wrong to someone else, and then they seek their forgiveness, and the other one doesn't want to forgive anymore. The victim, yes, he is the victim. He or she are in the right, but they don't want to forgive. That's it, they've got this grudge, they've got this pride, they don't want to let go anymore. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, خُذِ الْعَفْوَ, pardon. Pardon one another, forgive each other. Even if someone done wrong to you, even if someone did something wrong to you, you have to forgive him. For the sake of Allah Azza wa Jal. At least if you don't want to do it for his sake, do it for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Someone wronged you. Someone transgressed against you. Someone done something wrong to you. Forgive him for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You don't have to carry this grudge, and that's it. I hate him to the Day of Judgment. And how many times do you hear this? I'm never going to forgive him. Even if he seeks my forgiveness, I'm never going to forgive him. I'm never going to forgive. I forgive, but I don't forget. Have you heard of that saying? You know, they just want to rub it in. You know what? I forgive you, but I'm never going to forget. We have these qualities, and these are bad qualities that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala doesn't want to see from us. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, خُذِ الْعَفْوَ, exercise pardoning. Pardon one another. Forgive each other. Tolerate each other. Understand each other. Embrace each other. Contain each other. Even if someone done something wrong to you, yes, you are in the right. Wallahi, you are in the right. And Allah knows you're in the right. And the Sharia says you're in the right. And the entire world acknowledges that you're in the right. And he is in the wrong. But forgive him for the sake of Allah. Do it for the sake of Allah. Is it too much for you to pardon someone for the sake of Allah, to forgive someone for the sake of Allah? If Allah forgives, who are you not to forgive? And how many people transgress against Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and he's their maker. He's their creator. He's their sustainer. And they transgress against Allah, and then they seek Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's forgiveness and pardon. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgives them, and Allah azza wa jalla pardons them. So if your brother or your sister are seeking your forgiveness, forgive them for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. At least they were brave enough to come and seek your forgiveness, seeking your pardoning. Pardon them for the sake of Allah azza wa jal. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commands the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to pardon. And this command of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala upon the Prophet alayhi salatu wa sallam doesn't stop at the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, but extends to every single follower of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to the Day of Judgment. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala also says, وَالْعَافِينَ عَنِ النَّاسِ وَاللَّهُ يُحِبُّ الْمُحْسِنِينَ. Allah is describing the believers. And what are the qualities that the believers carry? And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala describes them to be وَالْعَافِينَ عَنِ النَّاسِ, those who pardon people. That's a quality, a trait of a believer. He pardons others. Doesn't always carry that grudge in their heart that, see, I just want to take him down, I want to rip him apart, I just want to do this and do that. I want to take revenge and retaliation. That's not Islam. Islam is beyond that. And the quality of a believer is beyond that. And you are beyond that. We are beyond grudges. We are beyond spitefulness. We are beyond hatred. We are believers. That's why we are believers, because we are beyond all this. What makes me different than everyone else if I carry like what everyone else carries and I do what everyone else does? There's no difference between me and them. If they don't forgive and I don't forgive, then I'm like them. If they don't pardon and I don't pardon, I'm like them. If they don't accept others and I don't accept others, I'm like them too. You're a believer, unique. You're unique, why? You are unique because of your characteristics. You are unique because of your trait. You are unique because of your quality. So keep yourself unique. If you're going to be like everyone else, then you are like everyone else. And you'll be treated like everyone else. And you'll be looked at like everyone else. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commands, خُذِ الْعَفْوَ, O Muhammad, pardon. فَاصْفَحِ الصَّفْحَ الْجَمِيلِ, pardon the beautiful pardoning. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants us to pardon in a beautiful manner. Not, okay, I forgive, but I don't forget. Subhanallah, you're trying to reconcile between two people, trying to sort out between two people, and then one says, you know what, I forgive you. But you know what, I want to tell you something, I'm never going to forget. And it happens a lot, especially between husband and wife. You try and reconcile between the two, khalas, alhamdulillah, it's all over. That's it. We've forgotten about the past. 1 hour after that, remember 20 years ago? Like, we haven't even finished 20 minutes ago. It hasn't even been 20 minutes. You want to remind me of 20 years? Remember 20 years ago? I would never ever forget that. Like, didn't you just forgive me? Yeah, I forgot. I forgave, but I didn't forget. Subhanallah, where's the quality of a true believer? فَاصْفَحْ الصَّفْحَ الْجَمِيلِ, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, and pardon them. Pardon them in a beautiful, generous pardoning. Forgive them in a beautiful, forgiving way. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants us that when we pardon nicely. We pardon generously. Not just pardon, just say, okay, you know what? I forgive, but I don't forget. No, pardon in a very nice way, in a generous way, in a respectful way. Be a true believer, my brother, my sister in Islam. Have the true traits and attributes and qualities of a believer. Be a true mu'min. Make yourself different than everyone else. How are you going to make yourself different than everyone else? By your looks? No, you're wrong. You've got a beard and the bikers have beard too. What looks? Looks mean absolutely nothing. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala doesn't look at your looks. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala doesn't look at your beard. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala doesn't look at your abaya. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala looks at your a'mal, your actions, your deeds. I'm not belittling a beard, wal-iyadu billah. It's a sunnah and it's fard for you to have a beard. I do believe that. But that's not the topic that we're talking about. It's not about what you display. It's about what you keep. It's about what's inside you. And part of the quality that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants to see in Sajj is that when someone seeks your forgiveness, you forgive him for the sake of Allah azza wa jal. At least if you can't do it for yourself, do it for Allah. And if it's too much for you to forgive someone for the sake of Allah azza wa jal, then I'm sorry to say, what can you do for the sake of Allah then? If it's too much for you to pardon someone for the sake of Allah or forgive someone for the sake of Allah, then what can you do for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? What can you offer for Allah azza wa jal? What are you going to lose when you forgive someone for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? It doesn't mean that if you pardon someone or you forgive someone for the sake of Allah, you have to associate yourself to them and you have to visit them every single day. At least take it out of your heart. Fasfah as-safha al-jameel. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commands the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to pardon generously, nicely, beautifully. وَالْعَافِينَ عَنِ النَّاسِ وَاللَّهُ يُحِبُّ الْمُحْسِنِينَ. And those who pardon others, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala loves the good doers. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala described it to be as an action of the muhsineen. When you pardon others, you forgive others, this is an action of a muhsin. And who is a muhsin? A good doer. A good doer. Someone who practices good. This is the quality of a believer. Okay. That's what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said to the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Did the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam practice that in his life? Did the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam exercise this in his life? Yes, and absolutely yes, in the best form. In the greatest form, in the greatest example. And the first hadith illustrates that. وعن عائشة رضي الله تعالى عنها قالت للنبي صلى الله عليه وسلم هل أتى عليك يوم كان أشد من يوم أحد قال لقد لقيت من قومك وكان أشد ما لقيت منهم يوم العقبة إذ عرضت نفسي على ابن عبد يا ليل ابن عبد كلال فلم يجبني إلى ما أردت فانطلقت وأنا مهموم على وجهي فلم أستفق إلا وأنا بقرن الثعالب فرفعت رأسي فإذا أنا بسحابة قد أضلتني فنظرت فإذا فيها جبريل فناداني فقال إن الله تعالى قد سمع قول قومك لك وما ردوا عليك وقد بعث إليك ملك الجبال لتأمره بما شئت فيهم فناداني ملك الجبال فسلم علي ثم قال يا محمد إن الله قد سمع قول قومك لك وأنا ملك الجبال وقد بعثني ربي إليك لتأمرني بأمرك فما شئت إن شئت أطبقت عليهم الأخشبين قال صلى الله عليه وسلم بل أرجو أن يخرج الله من أصلابهم من يعبد الله وحده لا يشرك به شيئا. سبحان الله, amazing hadith. Listen to this story. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is commanding the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to forgive, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is commanding the followers of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to forgive, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commands the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam numerous times, multiple times, oh Muhammad, forgive, 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 and pardon, and pardon, and pardon. Why is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commanding the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to forgive and pardon? Because the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam had encountered a lot of hardship. He had encountered a lot of difficulties. He had encountered a lot of insults from his people. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is training the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and developing the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam that even though he is encountering and will encounter wrongdoings from his own people, but we want to teach you to forgive them for the sake of Allah. We want to teach you, O Muhammad, to forgive them even though they are your enemies. Even they hate you, even though they worked against you, even they persecuted you, even though they insulted you, even though they abused you, even though they're this and even though they're that, at the end of the day, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants to teach the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam that whatever you experience and whatever you see from your enemies, forgive them for the sake of Allah. And the hadith that I just read to you is one amazing hadith where Aisha asked the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, O Messenger of Allah, have you ever encountered or experienced a day? Have you ever encountered or experienced a day upon you that's worse than the day of Uhud? And we all know what happened during the expedition and the battle of Uhud, in which the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and the Sahaba did not win the battle. And there was a mounting pressure that came on the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to kill him, where the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam resorted to the mountain, and we all know the story. So Aisha is asking the Prophet alayhi salatu wa sallam, O Messenger of Allah, have you ever experienced a day worse on you than the day of Uhud? So the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam replies back and he says, yes, Yes. You think the day of Uhud was harsh on me? When the people of Quraysh tried to kill me? When the people of Quraysh gathered and united to kill me? No, no, no. I've experienced a harder day than this day. I've experienced a lot more harsher day and more difficult day than this day. What day is when the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam went to At-Ta'if. At-Ta'if is about 100 kilometers away from Mecca. The city of Ta'if is about 100 kilometers away from Mecca. The Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, after a number of years where the Prophet alayhi salatu wa sallam is preaching and calling his people to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam continued to see an escalating resistance from his people, so the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam decided to go to At-Ta'if, which is about 100 kilometers away from Mecca, where the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam thought of a new strategy, where the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam would go out of Mecca and start preaching to the people outside Mecca, hoping that the people outside Mecca will support the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam later on, even against the people of Mecca. So the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam went to the people of Ta'if. And the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam named them the children of Abd Yalail and Abd Kilal. The Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam went to the city of Ta'if, and he went and met with the leaders and the chiefs of Ta'if. There were three brothers. There were three brothers. They were the sons of their father, who was the chief and the leader of At-Ta'if. When the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam stood in front of him and he started to call him to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, invite him to Islam, they started to make mockery of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. You think people make mockery of you? You think people are going to say, you're Muslim, or go back home, go back where you came from, look at your beard, take off your scarf? You think that's an insult? Well, hear what the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam had experienced. Hear what the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam had encountered. They made mockery of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. They said to him, you, out of all people, Allah chose you to be the one that represents him, to be the prophet and messenger of him. If you were the last person on the face of this earth for me to use as a prophet and messenger, you would have not been even him. And one of them said, if the Kaaba walks to us to here from Mecca to Ta'if, telling us that you are the prophet and the messenger of Allah, we're not even going to believe it. Making mockery of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. You think that you're encountering hardships and people till you go back where you came from? They made mockery of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and abusive statements against the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And not only that, but when the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam saw the resistance of the people or the leaders of At-Ta'if towards the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and the da'wah of the Prophet alayhi salatu wa sallam, and he saw their cruelty, the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam told him, if that's the case, just let me leave in peace. Khalas, that's it. Let me walk out of At-Ta'if in peace. Do you think that let the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam exit or walk out of At-Ta'if in peace? They gathered all their young boys, all their youngsters and their slaves, and they ordered them to stone the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam with rocks and make abusive, offensive comments to the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Swearing at the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, insulting the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, calling your beloved Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam the greatest man to ever tread this earth, calling him with names and swearing at him sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, on the top of all this, stoning him, throwing rocks at him, not looking at him and saying, you bloody Muslim, go back where you came from. And subhanallah, because of that, she takes off the hijab and the brother shaves his beard and he changes his name from Muhammad to Michael, and that's it. Then anyone, I'm a Muslim. I don't want anyone to know I'm a Muslim now. Who are you compared to the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam? It comes with a package. It's part of the package, my brother, my sister in Islam. When you stand up for the truth and you advocate the truth and you call for the truth and you call to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, expect it. Expect it's part of the package, including the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So now the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi salatu wa sallam, he's not let to leave At-Ta'if in peace. He was abused sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, verbally abused sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, insulted sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He was stoned sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, so much so that the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam bled. And the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam came out of the city of Ta'if bleeding. Not just with a broken heart, with wounded body, injured body. And then the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam managed to escape from the cruelty and the brutality of the people of Ta'if until the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam managed to exit Ta'if. And he had with him one of the companions, Zayd ibn Haritha. He had one of the companions with the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam who tried to protect the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam and defend the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam. But when the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam came out of the city of Ta'if, now the big test comes. What's the big test? Listen to this test. And this is exactly what we read in this hadith. Jibreel alayhi salam descends down to the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam with the mountain, with the angel of mountains. Jibreel descends down to the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam with the angel of mountains. And he says to the Prophet alayhi salatu wasallam, "O Muhammad, Allah had heard what your people had told you. Allah heard everything. And Allah had saw, or Allah had seen everything. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had did everything, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala saw everything. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had seen it all. So don't think Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala doesn't know about it. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows everything, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala heard everything, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala saw everything. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala heard what these people had said to you, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala saw what these people had did to you." Subhanallah. Amazing. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had heard what these people had did to you, and Allah azza wa jal had seen what these people had done to you, O Muhammad. And the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the Prophet alayhi salatu wa sallam is listening to Jibreel alayhi salam with the angel of mountains. And then Jibreel alayhi salam says to the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, "O Muhammad, I've got the angel of mountains with me." So the angel of mountains tells the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, "O Muhammad, Allah sent me to you for you to honor me. Whatever honor that you want, I'll do. If you want right now for me to grab two mountains and crush it over these people who just insulted you and these people just abused it, I'll do right now." You put yourself in that position. I'll tell you, finish them off and their entire progeny. That's our reaction. Our reaction is, end them off. Get rid of them all. These people just hit me. These people just abused me. These people just called me these names. These people just stoned me. You know what? Crush them all. Don't even leave a person amongst them. Not even a living being amongst them. But that's not the character of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And that's not what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commanded the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to do or react. فَصْفَحْ الصَّفْحَ الْجَمِيلِ. O Muhammad, forgive in the most generous way of forgiving. Pardon them in the most beautiful way of pardoning. خُذْ الْعَفْ. O Muhammad, exercise and practice pardoning. Forgive. So the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, after he was abused sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, after he was insulted, after sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was stoned, after the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was sworn at, after the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam experienced all that, and Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, "No, I'm not going to accept that. Do not crush anything on them. Don't destroy them. Maybe." And I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that Allah Azza wa Jal will guide even one person out of them that says, "La ilaha illallah Muhammadur Rasulullah." Subhanallah. The character of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The amazing character of the Prophet alayhi salatu wa sallam. The qualities of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Implementing what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had commanded him to do. خُذِ الْعَفْوَ وَأْمُرْ بِالْعُرْفِ وَأَعْرِضْ عَنِ الْجَاهِلِينَ. O Muhammad, exercise forgiveness. Implement forgiveness in your life. Even though these people had done something wrong to you, had wronged you, even though these people had done something which is so bad, that abused you, that insulted you, that swore at you, but at the end of the day, you are bigger than that as a Muslim. That's the message. You are always bigger than that. You know, our biggest problem is my brother, my sister in Islam. If someone swears at you, swear back at him. We've got that mentality in our mind. That's a mentality. Someone swears at you, swear back at him. He hits you, hit him twice. He gives you a dirty, no, give him 10 dirties. That's our character. But that's not the character of a true believer. That's not the character of a true mu'min. It's not always retaliation, tit for tat. It doesn't work that way. It's not tit for tat. It's not you hit me, I hit you. You swear at me, I swear at you. You push me, I push you. It doesn't work that way. You hit me, you know what? I'm going to forgive you for the sake of Allah. You swear at me, I'm going to make dua for you. Subhanallah, that's the character of a believer. We're all trying to become believers here. We are believers, but we're all trying to become the best of believers. I want to be not only a believer, every single one of us here is a believer, but I want to be the best of believers. I want to acquire the highest level of iman. But that doesn't come cheap. It doesn't come for free. You need to work hard for it. And amongst the things that you need to endure and amongst the things that you need to work hard for is that if you encounter any hardship from someone or any insult or any offensive things from someone or someone does something wrong to you, forgive for the sake of Allah Azza wa Jal. These days, my brothers and my sisters, we don't even forgive our own brothers and sisters from our own mothers and fathers. Your own brother and sister, blood brother and sister. Just because she said something that you didn't like, or he said something that you don't like, we don't even want to forgive him. We don't even want to talk to him for the rest of our lives. What happened? What happened to these verses? Where does this verses fit in your life? Well, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, خُذِ الْعَفْوَ, pardon and forgive. فَاصْفَحِ الصَّفْحَ الْجَمِيلِ, فَاصْفَحِ الصَّفْحَ الْجَمِيلِ, forgive generously for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Aisha says, مَا ضَرَبَ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمْ شَيْئًا قَدْ بِيَدِهِ وَلَا امْرَأَةً وَلَا خَادِمًا إِلَّا أَنْ يُجَاهِدَ فِي سَبِيلِ اللَّهِ وَمَا نِيلَ مِنْهُ شَيْءٌ قَطْ فَيَنْتَقِمُ مِنْ صَاحِبِهِ إِلَّا أَنْ يَنْتَهَكَ شَيْءٌ مِنْ مَحَارِمِ اللَّهِ تَعَالَى فَيَنْتَقِمُ لِلَّهِ. الله أكبر. Aisha also says, and she describes the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam. The Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam never struck or hit anyone. And the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam never laid a finger on a woman or a slave. Never hit anyone sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Never sallallahu alayhi wasallam struck anyone alayhi salatu wasallam. Only in the path of Allah. Only in jihad. That's the only time the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam hits. And that's the only time the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam strikes. And then she says a beautiful thing. And listen to this, my brothers and my sisters in Islam. And if the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam is wronged, if someone does something wrong to the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam or offends the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam, the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam will never ever retaliate for himself, only if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is disobeyed and only if he retaliates for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So his retaliation is only for Allah, to please Allah, not to please themselves. Our retaliation is for ourselves. Rarely that we retaliate for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Because of our pride, our arrogance, our ignorance, we retaliate for ourselves. I'm not saying here they accept to be the person that's pushed around. No, they don't accept to be pushed around. But at the same time, if you want to retaliate, retaliate for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You want to respond, respond for the sake of Allah azza wa jal. You want to speak, speak for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Then and there, my brother and my sister, when you're encountering that difficulty, when you are facing someone who's doing something wrong to you, that's the time that you prove yourself that you're a true believer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. As the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, إِنَّمَا الصَّبْرُ عِنْدَ الصَّدْمَةِ الْأُولَى. That patience is in accordance to the moment that you encounter hardships. It's not like when you encounter and you are struck with a hardship, and then you do whatever you want to do, and you scream and you shout and you say whatever you want to say, and then later on, inshallah, إِنَّ اللَّهَ مَعَ الصَّابِرِينَ. أَنُوا صَابِرِينَ. What صَابِرِينَ are you talking about? Did you leave sabr? You did not even leave any sabr in your life for you to say, إِنَّ اللَّهَ مَعَ الصَّابِرِينَ. What sabr are you talking about? There's not a word that you didn't say. And there's not even a war that you didn't punch. And there's not even a person that you didn't strike. وَإِنَّ اللَّهَ مَعَ الصَّابِرِينَ. What sabr are you talking about? You're not sabur. Patience at the very beginning. When you are struck with it, then and there, how are you going to react? When someone is swearing at you, someone is abusing you, then and there, what's your reaction? What, you're going to scream and shout, you know what, I'll take it on, bro, let me see this and that, yalla, bismillah, let me get my brothers and let me get the entire gang. And then, you know, inna Allah ma'a sabirin, anu sabirin. What sabr did you exercise here? You have absolutely no sabr. Sabr is at the beginning, not later on, after the damage had taken place. Sabr when you are getting insulted. Sabr when someone is swearing at you. Sabr when someone is doing something wrong to you, that's when you have sabr. But after you've done everything that you needed to do, and now Allah, sabr? What sabr are you talking about? What sabr? Inna Allah ma'a sabirin. Shu sabr? What sabr? What are you talking about? At the beginning, sabr. Sabr later on. There's no sabr later on. After you've damaged everything in Allah ma'a sabirin, it's like, you know, you ate everything, inshallah, I'm going to be on a diet. On a diet, you just ate everything. What diet are you talking about? You know, you've got that character, mashallah. If they could even eat the plate, they eat it. And then you know what? I'm on a diet. What diet? Diet is before you eat, not after you eat. Sabr. Say, alhamdulillah. Someone swore at him, he swore at him 10 times. Someone pushed him, he killed him. Someone done this, he did 100 times more than him. Then you know what? I'm going to forgive him for the sake of Allah. Forgive what? You've done everything that you needed to do. You didn't even leave anything. إِنَّمَا الصَّبْرُ عِنْدَ الصَّدْمَةِ الْأُولَى. As the Prophet Muhammad says, that patience is at the very beginning. Patience is at the very beginning. What's your reaction at the very beginning? That moment when someone is getting at your nerves, someone is pushing you around, someone is saying something to you, someone is doing this, someone's doing that. Then and there, what's your reaction? Are you going to swallow it for the sake of Allah and say, you know what, I'm just going to ignore him for the sake of Allah? That's patience. That's wisdom. That's pardoning. That's forgiveness. But after you've reacted and retaliated and you've done everything that you wanted to do, then inshallah, inna Allah ghafur rahim. Sabur inshallah. No, habibi, not sabur. You don't have sabr. And you don't have pardoning. And you didn't forgive. You've done everything that you wanted to do. You've done everything. Don't worry. You've retaliated and you've done everything. So the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam, if he ever retaliated, he retaliated for the sake of Allah azza wa jal. If he ever retaliated, the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam retaliated for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. His retaliation is for the sake of Allah azza wa jal. Subhanallah, when you look at the character of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, it's just amazing. Abdullah ibn Mas'ud, he says, كأني أنظر إلى رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم يحكي نبيا من الأنبياء صلوات الله وسلامه عليه ضربه قومه فأدموه وهو يمسح الدم عن وجهه ويقول اللهم اغفر لقومي فإنهم لا يعلمون الله أكبر. Abdullah ibn Mas'ud, he says, I could see our beloved Prophet Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم is that prophet that his own people went against him, his own people abused him, his own people struck him, his own people hit him, his own people waged war against him. And the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam is bleeding and he's wiping the blood of his skin. He's wiping the blood of his head or his body. And at the same time, the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam is saying, Allahumma ghfir liqawmi fa'innahum la ya'lamun. Oh Allah, forgive my nation and my people don't know. Allahu Akbar. That's forgiveness. He's getting attacked. He's bleeding. And at the same time, he's making dua for those who attacked him. He's getting attacked, he's bleeding, and he's wiping off the blood of himself. And the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam is making dua saying, Allahumma ighfir liqawmi fa innahum la ya'lamun. Allah forgive my people and my tribe, they don't know. And look, subhanAllah, not only Allahumma ighfir liqawmi, but even the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam is justifying their action in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They just don't know, ya Allah. Just forgive them because of their ignorance, and they just don't know. Because the Prophet Muhammad doesn't want to see anyone in the hellfire. The Prophet Muhammad didn't come into this dunya to see people and find people in the hellfire. The Prophet Muhammad came into this dunya to save people from the hellfire. That's why Nabi got up when he saw a non-Muslim funeral procession that walked beside the Prophet Muhammad. So they said, O Messenger of Allah, you are standing up for a non-Muslim procession? And Nabi said, yes. Isn't it a soul? And I'm crying because this is a soul that could prevent it from the hellfire. Subhanallah. Character of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. True character of a true believer sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So now Nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam is getting attacked. And Nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam The non-believers are attacking the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam and offending the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, and in return the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasalam is making dua for them for Allah to forgive them. And at the same time the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasalam is justifying it. Say, Ya Allah, because of the ignorance, Ya Rabb. فَإِنَّهُمْ لَا يَعْلَمُونَ Ya Allah. Allahu Akbar, how amazing is the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasalam. He could have said, Ya Allah, just forgive him. But deep inside, you know what, maybe these guys deserve it. But this is something that reflects and attributes to the character of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasalam. It reflects what's in the heart of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Ya Allah, forgive them. They just don't know. They don't know any better. Ya Allah, forgive them. They don't know any better. They just didn't know. Ya Allah, forgive them just because they don't know, Ya Allah. And the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam knows that these people are against him. But the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam is the one that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commanded in the Quran al-Kareem, خُذِ الْعَفْوَ وَأْمُرْ بِالْعُرْفِ وَأَعْرِضْ عَنِ الْجَاهِلِينَ. Exercise pardoning. Forgive. And when you forgive, forgive generously for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam says, لَيْسَ الشَّدِيدُ بِالسُّرْعَةِ إِنَّمَا الشَّدِيدُ الَّذِي يَمْلِكُ نَفْسَهُ عِنْدَ الْغَضَبِ. Alayhi salatu wasalam says that the strong man is not the one that knows how to wrestle people or the one that knows how to fight and takes on people. The strong man is the one that knows how to control himself when he's angry. The strong man is the one that knows how to control himself when he's angry. These days we look at someone, mashallah, because he's big, he's built, that's it, he's strong. Yes, he is strong. But in Islam, when you control your anger, you're a lot more stronger even though you're so skinny. Strength is not just about the muscles that you have, the big biceps that you've got, and how much weight you could push. Strength in Islam is when you control your anger. This is exactly what the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam is saying. You want to exercise muscle? Exercise the muscle of forgiveness. That's the strongest muscle. That's the power. You forgive for the sake of Allah. Pardon for the sake of Allah. When you are so angry, control yourself. Now you're talking about a strong person. But when you get angry and you can't even control yourself to the extent that you do whatever you want, you say whatever you want, there's no strength in you, I'm sorry to say. And subhanAllah, it's very sad to see that once some of us, when we get angry, Allahu Akbar, we become like wild bulls. Do whatever we want to do and we justify it. We will justify it, subhanAllah. We'll justify all our actions. Why? Because I'm angry now. So what? When did Islam ever say if you're angry, you could do whatever you want? You have no rights for you to do what you want if you get angry. Getting angry is not justifiable for you to do whatever you want, to say whatever you want, to strike whoever you want, to exercise whatever you want. You don't have that right. And that's why the Sharia say, if you want to consider yourself strong, then contain yourself when you're angry. Control yourself when you're angry. The strong person is the one that controls himself when they are angry. When they are angry. So my brothers and my sisters, let us follow the footsteps of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Follow the teachings of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Exercise forgiveness rather than you exercising retaliation. Exercise love and respect rather than you exercising disrespect and hatred. That's not Islam. That's not the character of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And subhanAllah, if you want to talk about these, there's so many stories that we could talk about and how the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam used to react according to the pleasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala when he used to get angry or when someone is doing something wrong to the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. But unfortunately these days, when we get angry, we will justify any action that we do. We will justify because I'm angry. I just couldn't control myself. You're a believer. You must control yourself then and there. This is the time that you must control yourself. We just came back from Umrah last week. And we go to Hajj every single year. Wallahi, on the day of Arafah. On the day of Arafah. Where people just make dua to Allah Azza wa Jalla and ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for His forgiveness and saw His forgiveness and mercy on that day. And then because of the bus, just because of the bus was delayed half an hour, an hour, people start losing the plot. They start fighting one another. And they're all in a state of ihram. Where? At Arafah. When? In Arafah. Subhanallah. Where? Arafah, on the day of Arafah. And they start losing the plot. I've seen people, they start swearing at one another. Why? Because of a bus. Stuff the bus. Who cares about the bus? You just finished from a beautiful day, the most beautiful day in your life. The greatest day that you'll ever experience in your life, the day of Arafah. At Arafah. And now you want to fight with your brothers and sisters over a bus, over a seat? Or why is the bus delayed? Subhanallah. خذ العف وأمر بالعرف وأعرض عن الجاهلين. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commands the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to exercise forgiveness. This is the time that we forgive each other. Whether at Arafah or outside Arafah. This is the time that we need to contain one another, have forgiveness and pardon each other. Not always just point the fingers at this person and point the fingers at that person and search for the faults of this person and the faults of that person. And if someone says something to me, I say it back. Subhanallah, you've got typical people. They teach their kids, if someone swears at you, you swear at him 10 times. If they hit you, hit them 10 times. If they smash you, kill them. That's the teachings of the mom and dad these days. MashaAllah. No wonder you've got issues at home. No wonder you've got domestic violence at home. Stupidity. This is where you find a lot of parents teaching their kids. Whoever hit you, hit him. Huh? It's not like there's a bit of a civil way, get to the teacher, this and that. If they swear at you, swear at them and their father and their mother too. Subhanallah, what kind of a character is that? That's not Islam, that's not the teachings of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam. What happened to the verse where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, فَاصْفَحِ الصَّفْحَ الْجَمِيلِ. Forgive in the most generous and the most beautiful way of forgiving. What happened to that verse? Why? That doesn't exist. Allah doesn't know what he's talking about. And you know what you're talking about, وَلَعْيَاذُ بِاللَّهِ. You know what, better, alhamdulillah. Astaghfirullah al-Azim. Why don't we teach our children pardoning and forgiveness? Why don't we instill in the minds and the lives of our kids pardoning and forgiveness? Why is always enough violence and retaliation and reaction? Subhanallah, that's why when they grow up, you say no to them and see what's going to happen. You taught them to be that way. فَاصْفَحْ الصَّفْحَ الْجَمِيلِ. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make us from amongst those who pardon and forgive one another for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Ameen, Ya Rabbil Alameen.
Every Muslim dreams to be up in Jannah. It pies person's destiny. Inshallah, in Jannah.